Kate Harris, I'm from Limerick and I'm going to be talking about my family history research, which concentrates on my paternal side the Harrises and my maternal side the Clarks. So, first thing we learned about ancestral research from Lorna and from almost every other clans and surnames presentation that followed was to begin with yourself and work backwards. So I did what I was told and mapped out all the relatives I knew and as far back as I could go and listed all the information I knew about them. From here I decided I would concentrate on the Harris family, as my uncle had already begun looking into our family history in the 70s. So I had kind of stuff to cross-reference with. Then I started with my, I began with Joseph Da Harris, my great-grandfather. I knew he was buried in Mount St. Aran Cemetery from visiting it when I was a child, and I decided to look up the burial records and found, so he's the first one, Joseph Harris, and he was buried in 1969 at the age of 82, so I got an idea of his age, and I used Irish genealogy.ie to search for his birth cert using 1887 as his year of birth and registration date, district as Limerick. So he's the only result I found that matched, and I found he was born to another Joseph Harris and Bridget McMahon on the 23rd of November 1887 in Charlotte's Quay in Limerick City. And then because he has the same name as his father, I'm just going to refer to him as Da for the rest of the presentation, because that's what his kids and grandkids called him to make it less confusing. So from here, I decided to go for the 1901 census. The census shows that Joseph's family are living in 10 Michael Street. Dad's mother, Bridget, that's picture for there, is the head of the family after her husband's death. The three of Dad's siblings, as well as two boarders, are also living in the one tenement flat. This gives an idea of the crowded living conditions in the tenements, with seven people living in small rooms. And then that's just the area they lived in. So Michael Street is over there by the town hall. Then in the 1911 census, I found that the living conditions were much the same, but they were living in a different tenement building in Dixon Lane. So in the census, there are six people living in the one flat. Dad, his mother, his sister, and her family are also living there. So her husband, Dennis Murphy, and their two kids. So it's very crowded conditions. And Dad is the only person with a job in the whole flat. Then I went on to his marriage cert, because I knew that he married Bridget Milan, who's actually related to Ernie's Milan's. The marriage cert told me that they were married on the 11th of June 1911, and it also told me that Dad's father was employed as a brushmaker. I also got information about Bridget's family, which told me that her father's name was Michael Milan and he was a car driver. So Dan and Bridget had seven kids together. That's Maureen, Christopher, Paddy, who would be my grandfather. Then they had twins named John and Michael, and then Edward Harris. And this was between 1913 and 1928. So I found out from my dad that my great-grandfather, Joseph, used to live in tenements on George's Quay. I decided to research tenement conditions to get an idea of what their living conditions were like, and I found a 1935 letter to the editor from the Limerick Leader, where a tenement dweller describes the difficulty for him and his six children, who were living in a single damp, cold room that must act as a kitchen, a dining room, a washhouse, coal house, and a lavatory. This really gave me an idea of what my great grandparents' living conditions would have been like, because they had five children when they were living in the tenement block. The conditions were so bad that in 1932 the tenement block they lived in collapsed, and there was such a shortage of houses at the time that the residents were housed in little white tents beside the river, the Abbey River, across from where the tenement block used to be. It's just really unusual to see the little white tents. I still don't know when it actually happened, but I assume it would have been really cold beside the river regardless of what time of year it was. The story then is that Eamon de Valera was campaigning in Limerick for the 1932 election, and he saw the tents and was wondering what they were there for, and when he heard the story, he organised for new houses to be built in Castle Barracks to house the residents. So as a result, Bridget and Dad were given a new house in Castle Barracks with flush toilets, cookers, which was such a luxury compared to the tenant blocks. They even had like their own little gardens. And these houses were built inside the 13th century castle walls, which is so strange to see. You can see like there's like gardens and walls, and like see dishes, like kids just running around playing inside the castle walls, which just looks so different now. I used to tell all my friends in school that my family came from a castle, and I was really proud of it when I was a little girl. So Joseph and Bridget lived in this house in Castle Barracks until her death in 1951 and his death in 1969, and then the houses were actually demolished in 1989, which is why we have the Great King John's Castle kind of museum thing now. And then that's a picture of Dad outside the house in the Castle Barracks that his granddaughter Maureen is my aunt. So then I moved on to Dad's father, Joseph, who was born in Charlotte's Quay, to parents William and Margaret Harris. So if you look, Charlotte's Quay is right across from George's Quay, where the other tenements collapsed. So at the time of his death then, Joseph was living in Bank Place, which is like right beside where he was born. And he married Bridget McMahon on the 12th of January 1878 in St. Michael's Church, and they had five children together and also lived in tenement throughout Limerick. So the Charlotte's Quay Bank Place, and then I also found them in Dixon's Lane. So then Joseph's father, William, was born in around 1821, and he also lived in Limerick City. He married Margaret Quinn in 1844 in St. Mary's Church, and they had nine children together. William worked as a brushmaker, which I found in the Slater's directory in 1870. It's just there at the bottom. His business was in Clare Street, which is kind of up the road from where they all lived. He also had employees, which I found in the Penny Court session. He took one of his employees to court, which is interesting to see how he had a proper business and employees working for him. And then Joseph also worked as a brushmaker, which is in the Limerick City directory. His business then was in John Street. The three generations really just lived in like the same areas and worked really close to each other. Then I found also in the Petty Court sessions that Joseph and his father William spent a month in prison in 1888 for larceny. So William Joseph, Joseph's wife Bridget, along with four O'Hallorans and McDonalds did meaningfully steal, take and carry a number of items from someone in Key Copeland. So these items include really random things like several tortoise shell lamps, a lot of books, a sewing machine table, a hammer, four walking sticks, brass curtain rings, part of a child's clock, two empty sacks. And then as a result, they were in prison for a month along with seven of the other involved men. I've no idea why they stole these random things. I assume it was either due to poverty or else maybe they were evicted and they didn't get to take their items with them before they left, but either way. The good thing about the prison records is I got a description of my ancestors. So Joseph is described as being 5'7", with brown hair and saddle complexion, so he's like the same height as me. And then William is described as being 5'8", with grey hair, brown eyes, and a fresh complexion. Joseph actually appeared in court numerous other times throughout his life, twice because he didn't pay his rent, and twice for being involved in assaults. One of the assaults was like in 1884 when Joseph and his wife Bridget assaulted someone named Patrick Shinquin, who was married to a Bridget Stapleton who used to be a Sheehan and who had been widowed. And then in November 1888, Joseph was assaulted by a John Sheehan who was married to his sister Mary. So the Sheehans and the Harrises obviously had some link together because they actually share a grave despite all the assaults, which is in Mount St. Aran Cemetery, which actually is very something through this book for finding dates and ages in my research. So William actually died in 1888, a few months after being released from prison at the age of 67, while Joseph died on the 19th of April 1894 of pneumonia at the age of 44 in the Limerick workhouse. So from the Harrises, I decided to move on to my clerks, who were a maybe different experience because they actually were from up the north, so I didn't have as much 1901 census, he was born on the 29th of April in 1900, so like 1 year old boy's named John Clark. And I found that John Clark in Antrim, and assumed it would be the right John Clark because his family members had very similar names to all my grandfather's siblings. So the census told me that his sister Mary Ann lived with their parents, an uncle and a boarder, and that his parents' names were Mary Ann and Bernard. What his parents' name was, then able to find their marriage cert. They were married in 1895, 5 years before John Clark was born and 3 years before his sister was born. And I also found out that Bernard's father's name was Mark and he was employed as a labourer. So I then looked in the 1911 census and was able to find Mary Ann and the kids, but Bernard was missing, so I thought maybe he abandoned his family or died. But I searched anyway for his name all over Ireland just to see, and he turned up in Louth, and it turns out he was visiting his parents and his daughter. So this was actually really lucky because it led me to back another generation and to Louth, where I found them in the census. So he's noted as a visitor, and then his daughter is there, and the rest of his siblings and parents. And then I decided to find his parents, Kate and Mark Clark, in the 1901 census, where the information is pretty much the same, except for Mark's job is noted as a general labourer rather than a corn porter, as it is in the 1911 census. So then I knew that John was in the military for my mother, so I decided to look for his military record on Ancestry. I found it. So his military record is to say the birth is the 1st of May rather than what I found, which is the end of April. And it details that he was in the army for 7 months, from 1918 to 1919, on a ship called Victory 2. And these records also told me his height and described him, which is 5'3¼", and described him as having dark brown eyes, hair, and a dark complexion. But that was funny that he's actually much, much smaller than me. So the height's obviously from my father's side. And then the next record I could find was John's marriage cert. So he married a lady called Catherine O'Brien on July 31st, 1923. And I saw that her father's name is Jeremiah Gleason, so I assumed she had been married before, which I thought was really interesting. So I decided I'd see what I could find about her. Also, it's in military barracks in Charleville, so he ended up in Cork somewhere from the north. Then I looked for Catherine O'Brien on the Irish genealogy.ie and found her birth cert, which lists her father as Jeremiah Gleason, which is the same as the marriage cert, so I knew this was the right page. Then I also came across Katie O'Brien, whose mother was named Catherine O'Brien, previously Gleason, and whose father is named Joseph O'Brien, so I assumed this is the first marriage. And this Katie O'Brien was born in 1914, so I assume that the marriage must have happened sometime between before 1914. So I checked the 1901 census for the family and found that, in the first census, Katie is 7, and she is in Scotland, so she's obviously not married yet. She's living with her mother Joanna and her father Jeremiah and her 3 siblings. I then went to look for the 1911 census but could not find any record of Catherine on it. I knew she would be about 17 according to the census ages and her birth cert, so I thought maybe she might have been married and left the country, but there was no record of the rest of any of her family who were mentioned at the 1901 census. So I began to think maybe there was some family tragedy or that they all moved away. I decided to search on Ancestry and came across a Hardyman family tree with Hannah O'Donnell, who was married to a Jeremiah Gleason and had a child named Katie. This tree was managed by Gabrielle from the US, and I decided to do a free trial on Ancestry so that I could get into contact with her. So she turned out to be Catherine's great-great-grandniece, as Catherine's sister Brady had moved over to America in 1925. And Gabrielle was also able to tell me that the Gleasons were on the 1911 census. They were just under the name Bussin, because it had been inscribed wrong. You can actually see, if you zoom in, it's hard to see on the screen, but the writing is really messy and it does look like Bussin. You can see how it could have been inscribed wrong. Even like, he said he's a fishmonger, but it's written as a kishmonger, so the writing had a big issue with that. I also found on Ancestry this photo of Joanna Neeson, Neil O'Donnell, in Charles in Cork. And it was really familiar to me because I had found a similar picture in my attic, which is this one here. So they're really alike. So I decided to message the woman who owned the picture and ask her if we had the same woman. So it was blind to a woman named Eileen who was living in the UK, and it turns out she was the great-grandchild of Jeremiah and Johanna, which is that lady there. And her mother was Katie's sister, Ellen, and she had also been living in Charleville in 1948 and had met Catherine Neeson and John Clark. So that was really interesting to find a connection of that on Ancestry. I eventually was also able to find Catherine's marriage cert to Joseph O'Brien, which was in 1913, and they were in Cork as well. And then I was also able to find her first husband's death cert, which tells me that he was 50 when he died, while Catherine was only 26, so there's obviously a really big age difference between them. 3 years after his death, then Catherine is married to John Clark, and she has my grandfather a few years after that, who is Jeremiah as well. So overall, my research was a really good experience. My artist's family research was a lot more straightforward because my uncle had made a start at it, and it was also local, so I knew the areas, I knew, like, I had been to graves, I knew where people were buried, I could get information from that. The Mount St. Aran's website was so good for getting records of people who aren't even marked on gravestones, and like, it's a searchable database, so I found that so handy. While with the clerics, it's all areas I'm not familiar with, like, I have no sense of geography, and I had no idea of any of the areas they were living in. Also, with the clerics, no one had really spoken to me about it before. I had no idea past my grandfather of anyone. And people hadn't really looked that far back before. They just had like a brief idea of names, but like they would have been mixed up. But overall, the research was really good experience for me because I got to know now that I do have roots in the north, and that like, my family did move around a lot, like Clarks were in Louth, then they moved to Antrim, then to Charleville, then to England, and then they finally ended up in Limerick, where I am still. I also got to make contact with the distant relatives who I've never heard about before, so that was a really nice experience as well. I know I'll keep going and find more. So that's the end of my presentation. Thank you.